Hello, welcome to the talk. We're going to explain how to do your first contribution to Rustc, the Rust compiler. To some, the Rust compiler is just the thing that yells at them when they run cargo build. Some people get curious about what happens under the hood, and the compiler holds all the answers. Getting a better understanding of the compiler by reading the code and starting to contribute to Rustc turns the angry red compiler errors into a helpful friend trying to guide you along on an adventure. We'll give you an introduction to the compiler and the teams, tell you about what you need to set up your dev environment, find a good first issue, work through an example issue, and explain the pull request workflow. We're going to present this talk as a whimsical kind of story with occasional breaks for more in-depth technical information. But first, we'd like to introduce ourselves. Hello, my name is Jay Haigh, and I'm Debug Steven on Twitter. I'm currently a Haskell developer at SimSpace. I'm organizing Colorado Gold Rust this year. It's on September 20th and 21st, if you're interested in attending. And I've contributed to a handful of Rust projects, including RustDoc inside of Rustc. I did my first contribution to Rustc at the Recurse Center last winter. The Recurse Center is a self-directed, community-driven coding retreat in New York City.
Hi, my name is Gray, but you might know me better as QuietMisdreavus on Twitter and GitHub and the like. I'm the lead of the RustDoc team, so I help out a lot with maintaining the RustDoc tool that runs inside CargoDoc and DocsRS, the documentation hosting site. Later this year, I'll also be attending the Recurse Center to spend even more time working on those things. But without further ado, let's jump right into our story. I'm sure many of you know our lovable mascot, Ferris the Crab. They're a curious sort, helped along by the friendly Rust community. Today, it looks like Ferris is hanging out on the beach, playing around. Oh, it looks like Ferris has found himself a little hole to burrow into. What have you found there, Ferris?
I've always been Rust's biggest fan. I just love the language, and I've gotten pretty good at writing Rust code. I want to know more about how the Rust programming language works. So today, as you can see, I'm digging into the sand to see if maybe I can find answers to my questions there.
Oh dear, that isn't any ordinary hole. It's a wormhole. Where do you think it will lead? This doesn't seem to have any visible bottom. It seems to just be tumbling downward and downward. Who knows where we might land? We could land in a magical other world or right back where we started. Who knows? Oh my. Look what's happened to you, Ferris.
Looks like I've landed on a desert island, but this isn't the same island I was playing on earlier. Who's that approaching?
Ahoy there. Welcome to the Rustc, home of Rustc, the Rust compiler. Who may you be?
I'm Ferris. The Rustc sounds like a fun place. I was trying to learn more about how Rust works and contribute back to the community. Can you show me around?
Sure. I can show you the lay of the land. I have a map right here. Here on the Rustc, there are many islands that you can visit. From Parser Island in the far west, you can continue on to Resolve Island, High Island, Check Island, Middle and Low Islands, and finally, Link Island in the far west. Each island has a special industry that contributes to its local culture, but that's just the main island chain. To kind of take a step back from the story a little bit, this corresponds to the flow of the compiler, you know? There's several steps that it goes through. There's the parser, the name resolver, there's the type checker and the borrow checker, there's sort of intermediate representations, high, middle, and low, and then at the end it links it into the final binary. So there's this like basic process that you go through. This is also why that if you're working on your code and it seems like you've gotten through all of your compiler errors, and then you're hit with a bunch more, that's because you've reached the next phase. You've reached the next island, so to speak. But let's jump right back into the story. There are many islands on the Rustc, and there are also many peoples. There's the industrious compilarians, keepers of the vast machines of the main islands. The resourceful Langians, painstaking designers of those machines. The studious Doxen, authors of great tomes of knowledge. The gregarious communitarians, always looking out for newcomers to the islands. The Craftsy Tool Crafters, creators of machines used by both the Islanders and people all over the world, and many more.
I want to be more than just the Rust language mascot. I want to be a pirate too in our quest to make the Rust Sea even better. How can I become a contributor to the compiler and get started?
Well, the easiest thing you can do is start with an issue to work on. That'll get you all the experience you need. If you want to just read about the current issues facing the islands, there's no better place than the Bounty Board. We try to keep it categorized, so you can look around for what pleases you. Some labels are valuable prizes, like E-Easy or E-Mentor. Those are prime targets for newcomers to snatch up, so be quick.
I'm more of a social type. I prefer to talk to people where they are.
Okay, let me take you to the watering hole. All the finest sailors plan their expeditions there. Welcome in. Looks like the special today are the Discord Drought and the Zulip Singer.
Wow, there's so many people here. I wonder if anyone here needs any help with anything. Excuse me, you there?
Yes.
Do you know if there's any trouble out on the Rust Sea?
Why, yes. There was a strange noise I heard when I was out sailing.
A strange noise when you are out sailing, you say?
I do.
I wonder what that could be.
Gosh. Well, I think I know some sailors who could help you out. Let's get started. So, taking a step back from the story a little bit, this is how you get started in the in contributions. You can find an issue that someone else is posted to work on, or you can kind of jump in with the teams and get invested in the lingo and stuff. The compiler repo and many of the official, like all of the official kind of Rust project repositories keep an in-depth issues page. And there's even a team of people specifically that keep up the issues and pull requests on the compiler repo. And there are a bunch of labels that we use, but the couple that I called out, E-Easy and E-Mentor, mean that either you don't need a lot of experience with the compiler to work on it, like it doesn't need a lot of in-depth knowledge, or that someone has laid out the steps to resolve it respectively. So like I said, if you find both of these on an issue, it's not likely to be there for very long. And if you're feeling more social, a bunch of the teams have chat rooms or places where they hang out. So you can go in, lurk a while, learn the lingo, find out things to work on before they're even posted, kind of as they're being designed. Let's hop right back in. If you want to go out on an expedition, you'll need to provision yourself a cannon. Fortunately, we can just clone you a new one. You'll also need some tools to get started. Your own clanging bell, a curled sword, I see you've got one already, a talisman we call the Vexatious Git, that should work nicely, and of course, your own live python. Also remember that you can tweak and configure your cannon to your liking. There's a configuration file that comes with it, so you can read through it all and see what tweaks you can make. And again, this ties back to Rust is built on GitHub. There's a nice repo and that you can fork for your own and clone yourself to get the code on your machine. There are a handful of dependencies to be able to build it. Like I said, curl, Git, a C++ compiler. I mentioned Clang, but GCC and MSVC work too, Python and CMake. And there's a configuration file. It's kept in the repo as config.toml.example. And that has all of the documentation for what each kind of knob and option does. When you want to tweak it for yourself, copy it in as config.toml and tweak away, and that'll play with your compile process. Jumping back in, now that we're all set up, let's get ready to fire. Remember, a pirate ship doesn't work the same as those cargo ships you might be used to. We do things a little differently around here. We use a tool called X. X marks the spot, you might know. But it should almost work the same as what you're used to. There's a check, a build, a dock, a test, same as usual. Just keep in mind, we fire our cannons in stages here. Keeps everything shipshape. Sometimes you'll be in stage one, sometimes stage two. It depends on what kind of expedition you're on. So, as I mentioned, building a Rust compiler, you don't use cargo directly. It has its own little build tool that manages putting the compiler together. Because the Rust compiler is itself written in Rust, It needs to kind of build itself a couple times to make sure everything is valid and you get a usable compiler at the end. So instead we use x.py, which is just this Python script that's included in the repo. And it works a little bit like cargo. You've got check, build, test, and doc. It has its own set of documentation, but it works roughly the same. And like I said, there's also stages because it kind of builds itself. So it, depending on what you're working on, you can kind of skip the last build and work on stage one, or sometimes you need to work on stage two. So you know, just kind of if you wonder which one you need, talk to someone on the compiler team. They'll probably point you in the right direction.
Fire! There are so many issues you can encounter when you're out sailing the Rust Sea. When you've found your own issue and your dev environment is all set up, you're almost ready to start writing code. At that point, you've probably read through the issue. Make sure you know the problem you're trying to solve and ask questions if there's anything you're unclear on. Asking questions either on the issue or in the team channel are the most likely spots to get answers. If you're working with someone or have been talking with the team, you may ask questions somewhere else or work with a mentor directly. Just ask the team what their preference is. Let's walk through an example and see about exploring the code and adding our own contribution to it. So PanicBit filed an issue that they wanted to see re-exported crates and crate items inlined in Rust doc. This code would display foo as if it were a module in the docs. This code would inline the re-exported items as if foo were a module. Inlining takes the items from one location and duplicates their documentation in another location. RustDoc code lives in the compiler repo in /lib/RustDoc. We can find the existing code for how crates and exported items are currently handled and then change it how we want it to be. From a high level, we know RustDoc walks through the generated abstract syntax tree and then cleans up the AST to remove duplications. This is where the implementation for how the docs should be generated lives. Let's look at the section of code for crates and crate items. This section of code currently cleans up the extern crate and returns a single extern crate item. Our implementation for showing the exported crate and items needs to go inside the clean trait function for an extern crate. We know that we may return multiple items since there are many items that can be exported from a crate. We want to add the items' names to a please inline list if we have the doc inline attribute above the item. We want to iterate through our items, and if the item is in the please inline list, we want to try to inline that item. Luckily, we saw there is a try inline function. There are certain situations where an item can't be inlined. Either it's local or we're not going to generate it for a page, et cetera. So we need to take that into account when solving this problem. The logic ends up looking something like this. If there's a pub on the extern crate statement, start looking through the attributes. If there's a doc attribute above a statement, we'll look through the parenthesized list. Then, if there's an inline in that parenthesized list, we'll try to inline that item. In the if please inline block, if we found the doc inline attribute, we'll try to inline that item. We'll need to have an empty hash set for try inline.
Oh. Technical difficulties. I didn't see what it was.
We need an empty hash set for try inline. We also need a def, which the compiler uses to identify items in crates it compiles. This one corresponds to the root of the crate we're importing. Try inline returns an option. If it returns the crate's items, use that instead of the extern crate item, which we would otherwise return later on. The function signature also changes a little bit here. Instead of returning a single item, the crate, we might return the crate and the items exported from the crate. So we did a few changes to allow us to return a vector of items. Back where this function is called, we replaced our previous use of math with flat map. And we changed the impl queen to allow us to return a vector of items instead of a singular item. We also used the vec macro to wrap the extern create item array we originally returned when we weren't inlining. But we aren't done yet. We also need to add some new crates to test the code we just wrote and write some docs to make sure that users can verify this works, and so that they know how to use it for their Rust code. We add a sample case to the test suite. The RustDoc tests are a little special compared to the rest of the compiler, so we're not going to get into the details of how these tests work. We do have a companion blog post on both of our blogs full of links to where you can read more about this if you're interested.
So now that we've figured out the issue, solved it, and made our docs inline the extern crates, we need to let the islanders know so that they can tell everyone else about the new feature. They'll make sure everything stays shipshape.
How do we notify the islanders?
I'll show you. We sometimes call these broadcasts a pull, so we'll need to write a letter called the pull request, or a PR, so we can ask them to pull about our expedition.
Oh, I know about those from my other adventures.
Great. This should be a breeze then.
So when we're creating a pull request, we want to talk about the issue we're looking for and solving, and how we solved it. So you may want to link to the particular issue that you're fixing, if there is one. Here, our issue was about inlining extern crates on the sea near Parser Island. When we looked into it, we found the extern crates and their exported functions were not yet being shown as modules in our generated Rust documentation. So to add this feature, we implemented crean for extern crate items. And to make sure it stays fixed, we put in a check to make sure that our documentation generated the way we would expect. That should keep the docson happy.
Yeah. So now that we have the PR written up, let's send it off. They might write back to ask for more details or to go back and tweak the fix. But if they like it, they'll run it through a machine called Borse to pull it out to all the islands. It's also possible they'll turn it down.
Oh, no problem. Not every PR will land. But it's still a contribution of your time and knowledge, and walking away from every contribution teaches you something new. It's awesome to get code in, but you're always going to walk away with some sort of contribution.
Now that you have your first expedition under your belt, what do you think of life on the Rustc?
It looks like it's a pirate's life for me. Yarr! Yarr!
Thanks for coming in. If you want to read even more about how to contribute, like Jay said, we have a companion blog post on both of our blogs that goes into more detail about the workflow. There's also a great guide that the compiler team has put together about all the ins and outs of the compiler, how to build it, how testing works, and way more. That's the third link there. I've also put the link to the compiler repo itself, as well as the Discord where a lot of the teams hang out, and the Zulip where a lot more of the teams hang out. So thanks again, we hope you all enjoyed.